Rajendra bhai, can we start?
Yes.
Good evening all and welcome.
Good evening everyone. I am Venkatesh Kade. All on behalf of ISRI Ahmedabad chapter, I will request you to please mute your speaker and video before we start our today's webinar. Our webinar is on district cooling system by Mr. Gaurang Patel sir. I will request Prasanth Patak sir, our ISRI Ahmedabad chapter president, to give speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Tade, for giving me this opportunity, because it's always a privilege to introduce such a nice speaker, Gaurang Bhai Patel, and the person who really doesn't need any introduction, but still as a formality, let me go ahead with his introduction. Mr. Gaurang Bhai Patel is a manager engineering MEP at Rombol India currently. He is BE Mechanical from Sardar Patel University and has done ME on cryogenic engineering from the Gujarat University. He is ISRI member and ASHRAM member also, and has worked for the ISRI Ahmedabad chapter for quite a long time, and currently is serving ASHRAM Western India chapter as CTTC co-chair. His working experience says that he has more than 18 years of experience in the field of HVAC and R and MEP. He has served for a wide variety of projects for HVAC FFTG design, including infrastructure project, that is district cooling system, high-rise commercial building, hospital and laboratory, that is India, that's in India, Middle East and USA, hotel and commercial projects, data center, industrial project, pharmaceutical and bulk drug industry, and residential jobs as well. He also has an experience of air conditioning and heating system design for US-based project. He has served a team of India's first district cooling system at GIFT City, Gandhinagar, and currently is working, as I said, with Rombol India Private Limited, Mumbai, as an engineering and manager MEP. On his professional achievements, he has been awarded with as runners-up award. I mean, he is awarded with the runners-up award for trophy, which is trophy plus 50,000 rupees, during the 5th Briar Award for Excellence in HVAC and R in student category, held on 8th January 2010 in New Delhi. He has published article in ISRI Journal on India's first district cooling system at GIFT City. He has also published article in REWA, that Federation of European Heating, Ventilation and Air Conditioning Association and European Association of HVAC Industry, on India's first district cooling system at GIFT City in February 2018. Not only that, he has been recently selected as a TC on district cooling subject in ISRI headquarters also. So today he is synonymous to the district cooling subject. And without further ado, I would request Gaurang Patel to take over this webinar. Welcome, Gaurang Bhai.
Thank you, Prasanth Bhai.
Thank you, sir.
Rajendra Bhai, can you share? Can I share my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I hope you can able to see my screen now. I hope you are able to see my screen now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I would like to thank ISRI Ahmedabad chapter. For me, it is not like any host chapter. It is like my home chapter. It is like my family, Ahmedabad is. Though, like, because of the career requirement, I had to move to Mumbai, and currently I am a CWC members for Mumbai ISRI chapters. I always has been attached with the ISRI Ahmedabad chapter. So it is again good feelings for me to share a little knowledge what I have with my fellow members here. In terms of the today's subject, we are talking about sustainable and an energy efficient district cooling system. So at current moment, when we are at our home from last 2 months, we had observed a lot of changes into going on around us. If you see, we are getting a lot of good news that nature is getting flurries, and they are getting refreshed. We are getting a lot of IAQ is getting more better. The wildlife getting coming out of their normal range. And basically, the nature which is getting flourish more. So at this junction of time, we need to think on like where would like to go. Whether like in the picture we can see whether we would like to go on right side, that is greener side, or we would like to go on a like a darker side, that is like more like towards going on a dark side and going more and more away from the natures. So I would like to put some thoughts here, and then we will move ahead with the district cooling system. Just a minute. Something is going wrong. Okay. As part of contents, I would like to cover the background. I will cover these topics into my presentations. I will give you a little background. What is district cooling system? Why district cooling system? Various components of district cooling system and their importance. Benefit of district cooling system and challenges for district cooling system. Okay. Now, because I'm getting some lag into the system. It is taking some time when I'm changing the slide. This picture is very common. Commonly we had seen at various places. You stand at any of the crossroad and you will find all around your place, you'll find lot of outdoors. Maybe it is a DX system, maybe a VRF system, so maybe like air cool chillers. And our entire city is like full of this kind of outdoor units. And that indicates one thing, there is a growth in air conditioning demand. Second is also indicating that the outside temperature is rising day by day. And also, like as an air conditioning professional, we need to understand that whenever we do cooling inside, we are throwing out heat outside. Okay. So for example, whenever you are doing a cooling of 1 ton, you are throwing out heat of at least 1.25 tons. 25% more heat you are injecting outside in the atmosphere. So when you are cooling your inside space, you are heating up your outside space. So as you are growing your air conditioning demand, you are also increasing amount of heat which you are injecting into the atmosphere. So like if you see in terms of the in terms of like growth from 2018 to 2050, this is one of the projections I had taken from ASAI newsletters. So as per that, this reference, if you see for India, where we are having a current demand and growth in 2050, it is almost 7 times we are growing in the air conditioning demand in India. And this growth in demand is quite substantial compared to other countries, like if you see China or if you see any other countries. So when we are growing by 7 times, we will also need to understand that we will be throwing out 7 times more heat than what we are throwing out today. So today, if we are reaching up to 45 degree, what will be the temperature when we will grow our air conditioning business by 7 times? Because air conditioning is one of the factors for increasing the heat island effect. Okay. So currently we are reaching regularly of 45 degree temperatures. What will be the temperature we will be reached after we grow our air conditioning by 7 times? So like, what is the solution for that one? We need to think of in normal cases, when we are having DX systems or VRF system or air cool chillers, we are throwing out heat in terms of the sensible heat. But can we have any other source where it can throw heat out in a different form? Yes, like if we are using water cool chillers and we are throwing out heat with the help of cooling towers, that will be like in the form of latent heat. Okay, so that can be like that kind of solutions we need to think of. See, I do agree like lot of people working in our industries, I'm also one of you. So I also know like what are the challenges associated with the water cool chillers, why we are selecting VRF, why we are selecting DX systems, why we are selecting the air cool system, because there are a lot of constraints associated with that one. Okay. So, So one of the systems like will be the solutions can be like a district cooling system. If I go by definitions, what is district cooling system is a district cooling system distribute thermal energy in the form of chill water from a central source to multiple buildings. So they normally use a chill water as a source of thermal energy, and they will be having a central plant, and central plant to multiple locations, spread over multiple locations through your network of underground pipes for use in a space and process cooling. The cooling and heat rejection is usually provided from a central cooling plant, and thus eliminating the need for separate system in individual buildings. So like when we go for any definitions, it's a little bit tricky to understand. So it's better like if we try to understand from some sketches. So this is a simplified form of district cooling system. There are three primary components. One is a central chill water plant. So where instead of having a independent system into each building, where we are having always we are having a constraint in terms of the size, amount of cooling load or location of the units, space availability. Here we will be having a centralized plant. There won't be any system independent individually for each any for all the buildings. Then second component is will be chill water distribution network. So like here we are having a plant here, and then the piping will be hitting that will go up to the buildings. In the sketch we are also having a heating pipe also, because the district cooling system is a word used in a eastern part of the world, or we can say Southeast Asia and Middle East. But when we go in the colder countries, like in the western part, they are more on towards heating one. So they are using a district heating system, and commonly it is known as district energy. And the third component will be the system inside the building, that is the consumer system, because they will be receiving thermal energy from central plant, and they just need to do a circulation inside the building. So how will be the DC circuit in terms of the physical one? So like there will be, when we I say a plant, there will be a typical chill water plant will be there, where we'll be having the chillers, we will be having the pumps, primary pumps, secondary pumps, condenser pumps, cooling towers, that all kind equipments where what we see into any kind of water cool chillers, that component will be there into a district cooling plant. Obviously, that technical specification for them, it will be different. Okay, we'll come to that one when I take individual equipments. So this plant, then from plant, we will be generating chill water, and that chill water will be distributed through a piping to our independent buildings. And at each of the building, we will be having a heat exchangers. Okay, this will be normally a plate type heat exchangers. We are not using saline tube type heat exchanger here because of the approach required for a delta T. So this PHE or heat exchangers will be a battery point for the both the services. There will be on one side, there will be a DC water coming from the central plant or DCS plant will be there. And on another side, there will be water circulating inside the building will be there. So in the building, there will be a only the component will be the PHE, the circulation pumps, and the your AHU, FCU, or your cassette units, or whatever the your low side equipment will be there, and they will be on chill water system will be there. Sorry, I you will be find little lag between the two slides because somehow this system taking some time when I go to next slide. So this is, I said, like what is district cooling system? As I understand, like there's a central plant will be there. There will be a chill water network will be there, and there will be an end consumer, end user will be there. Now the second question is, why district cooling system? Why we should have a district cooling system? Okay. Though like let's say we try to understand from some example. Let's say let's say our cluster development of 40 million square feet. And let's assume that there are the 60% of the commercial area will be there, 30% of the residential area will be there, and around 10% of the social area will be there. So this is a way of taking one example just to understand why district cooling is required and what are the benefit associated with district cooling system. So if I take a cluster development of 40 million square feet with such kind of diversity of use, the total cooling load requirement will be 160,000 ton. Okay. And this is I had assumed like from the considering 250 square feet per ton. Okay. Because like and the power requirement for this 160,000 ton will be around 160 megawatt. Now, if you see here, when I had considered power requirement, I had considered 1 kilowatt per ton. So I had considered energy efficient water cool system here. I'm assuming that each building will be having a centralized system. Okay, I had not compared that was like if with DX or VRF system where we are having 1.2, 1.3 kilowatt per ton. Okay, so I'm considering right now 1 kilowatt per ton. And based on that one, we will be requiring 160 megawatt of power for this cluster as a for the air conditioning or conditioning requirements. But now this will be 160,000 ton will be my peak requirements. Okay. This will be like a typical load profiles we are aware about. So whenever like this is a peak requirement we will be having, and this peak requirement will take place into the your peak hours on the peak month between 12 to 4. Okay, but when I go for a district cooling system or centralized plant, I will be get a diversity of use. Now what is diversity? Because like see, whenever you design for your plant for any of the building, you always take some diversity. Because all the systems which is installed in your buildings are not going to run at the peak hours at the same time. So that diversity of use you always get into your building. So normally like based on the type of building, we take like certain times we take 75%, sometimes we take 80, 85%, 90% based on type of use. Okay. And as you are going for centralized plant, you'll be able to get this diversity. If you are going for an independent plant, you aren't able to get this kind of diversity. So if I go for central plant, I will get one more diversity that is between the various type of buildings, because one diversity we will be having that is diversity of use for each building and then for independent building, because in our clusters, there will be some of the residential buildings are there. There are commercial buildings, there are social buildings. So that if I try to take on a diversity on larger areas, I will get a bigger diversity. And that's, I can reduce down my peak requirement from 160,000 ton to 110,000 ton requirements. Almost like I had considered 70% diversity here. We can verify this one with the help of energy modeling of that entire cluster developments. So, and see the 70% is quite a good figure. We can see the average figures for various this kind of cluster development. So if you see here, my requirement has been come down from 160 megawatt of electrical requirement to 110 megawatt. So almost we can say there is 35% of energy saving is there. And this is in terms of energy power requirement from the grid. So you can consider that amount of reducing our demand itself. So we will be reducing the fossil fuel requirements. We will be reducing the power plant requirement itself. Okay. So the first step is here, you are getting 35% energy saving here. Now, whenever we go for any kind of selection of equipments for any kilowatt plants, we always select plant at the peak load capacity. For this case, the chiller whenever we are selecting chiller capacity, we will be selecting at a peak load. For this particular case, our peak load capacity is 110,000 ton. So my chiller capacity, I need to consider 110,000 ton because I had reduced my overall demand from 160,000 to 110,000. Now I need to select the chiller capacity as per 110,000 ton. Okay. Now, I am finding little difficult in terms of this time taken by the system. If you don't mind, can I just escape for a while and again open my PPT?
Yeah, Gaurav, please do that.
Yeah, yeah. Because somehow I'm finding it difficult.
So if you want to quit and then rejoin, right?
No, I'll just wait. I'm just trying to do that one, like just because somehow I'm not able to go back into my slides. Okay.
Rajendra bhai, can you stop? Sorry, Gaurav, you stop the screen sharing and then go back and then.
Yes. I did the same one.
Yes.
Prasanthi, I'm just rejoining the meeting.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Do you have a rights right now?
Happy to join you.
Yeah, okay. Let me share my screen. Sorry for this disturbance, because in the afternoon we tried one somehow at this moment it has not run into my regular Rajendra, can you cancel sharing from your end, because I am not able to cancel from here. It is taking some little more time because there is some issues is there. Give me 5 minutes. Can you just cancel sharing from your end?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Now you can do it.
Yeah, sure. Sorry, now it's okay. Sorry, everyone, for this little disturbance on my side. So, in terms of when we had discussed the peak load of 160,000 as for this cluster development of 40 million square feet area. And with the help of district cooling system, we had reduced down that one to 110,000 ton with the help of diversity across the overall area for this cluster development. Now, when we are selecting chillers for 110,000, we always consider the peak air conditioning loads. And we select the chiller capacity based on that overall peak load for peak months. Maybe that can be divided afterwards, two working one standby or three working one standby. Okay, but we know that they are running for this peak load only for 3 to 4 peak hours for 3 to 4 hours. Rest of the times they are running into part load conditions. Like if I take in the morning hours, or if I take the evening hours, or if it is 24/7 operations, the night hours will be the part load operations. Okay, so to optimize the chiller capacity, can we think of that storing the thermal energy into part load operation hours, that is like in the morning hours and in the night hours, where I am running my chillers into part loads, and I can store the thermal energy at some place, and I use that same thermal energy during the peak hours. So what the benefit I will get? I will be able to reduce my chiller capacity from the peak load, peak air conditioning load, to an average load. The average load is normally in the range of 65% to 70%. So if we do say that case, that one, we can reduce down our capacity from 110,000 to maybe in the range of around 75,000. See, this is a graphical sketch where we can see that the green part is a area where we are running our chiller capacity chillers into part load conditions, and we will be storing that. We will be running chillers full in the full capacity during that time, and we'll store that thermal energy into thermal storage. In terms of thermal storage, I will take in another sessions again another slide in more details how that happens. So we will be storing that additional thermal energy generated by the chiller in the part load into a thermal storage, and we will be using into the peak hours, like is marked as green pink colors. We will be using that thermal energy. So we will not be requiring chillers for the peak capacity. So instead of going for 110,000 chillers, we can go with the 75,000 chillers by taking around 65% of the average load and 35,000 as a TES tank. So that is a thermal energy storage tank we will be taking, and total will be 110,000. So initially we had taken like 110,000. And we had taking an electrical load of 110 megawatts. Now we have reduced the chiller itself to 75,000. So my electrical load requirement will be 75 megawatts. So we started with 160 megawatt and we come to 75 megawatts. So there is almost 50% energy saving is there. And this energy saving is in terms of the your demand itself. So the associated all component from the power generation, the fossil fuel requirement, the CO2 generations, every place is you are having that energy savings. So if you I ask the since this program is youth one, I will take their examples and their more attachment with them is their mobile. If I ask them, you'll be getting a 50% discount on your Apple phone tomorrow morning, so you will be finding the queue from the night itself, because we are getting a 1 lakh phone with a 50% discount. We are having a saving of 50,000 rupees. But here, like we are having a 50% energy saving, and this is not a one time. This is a over a period of time itself. And we are also saving the money also, and we are also saving in terms of the atmosphere also, because whenever you are reducing your power capacity, power demand itself, you are reducing the all associated environmental impact on the also. So now let's come to various components. Like if I go for district cooling plant, okay, what should be various component and what are the major technical specifications for various chillers, various components? So the first one and very important component is the centrifugal chillers. When we go for a district cooling plant, the capacity of the plant will be in a case of like 10,000, 20,000, 25,000. The kind of capacity will be there. Okay, so here the chiller capacity, independent chiller capacity will be in the range of 2000 to 3000 ton. So they are the larger capacity chillers. And when we are having this capacity, we will go for the centrifugal chillers. Secondly, important one, very important component is like when we are using for district cooling system, this will be a series counter flow arrangement type chillers. That is like if you see the sketch, you'll get a more idea. Like when I'm saying a series counter flow, so the chilled water supply and return temperature will be 5. I had taken example here is a 5 degree and 14 degree, because the delta T across the chiller will be in the range of 9 degree or 10 degree in most of the district cooling plant. So to achieve that large delta T, they are going for series counterflow arrangement. So when a return water comes at a 14 degree, is entering into first chillers, it dropped down by 4.5 degree or 5 degree and comes to a 9.5 degree. And this 9.5 degree water is again going into a second chillers and drop down by 4.5 degree and come out with a 5 degree or 4.5 degree temperature. Okay. So this one, like if you see this one, like to achieve 9 degree delta T or 10 degree delta T, they are arranged into series counterflow arrangement. For example, if we are going for a normal chillers, which are like 7-12, okay, you are having a 5 degree delta T. So a single chiller will serve. But if I go with a single chiller of 10 degree delta T or 9 degree delta T, the chiller's lift will not help me in terms of energy efficiency. Okay. So considering that constraint, we are going for series counterflow arrangement. And same is applicable for the cooling water also, the condenser water also. That also flows in a counterflow arrangement. So here we are having a chiller delta T of 9 degree. And current correspondingly, the chill water flow rate will be 1.5 GPM per ton or 1.4 GPM per ton based on the your delta T selection. Because in normal case, when we are having a standard chillers of 7-12, we are having a 2.4 GPM per ton. That will reduce down here to 1.5 GPM per ton. The benefit of this one is again goes to the parties like your chill water piping, which is like you are taking chill water distribution pipe from your plant to various buildings. Okay, so that pipe size will get reduced almost by 40%, and that will be again having a that also helps in terms of your pumping capacity also. Your pump requirement, pump power requirement also comes down in the proportionate to volume flow. The second important component are the pumps. Here the pump will be of higher capacity. In normal case, we are in our industry, we are used to have the pump of end suction pumps, because in most of the cases we are dealing in a capacity of 400, 500 tons capacity. But here we are going in a quite big capacity of 3000 tons and a multiple capacity. So this pump will be of a bigger capacity, and as per the maintenance requirements, there will be a horizontal split case type pumps. The motors will be energy efficiency one motors or IE2 motors will be used. So instead, that depends on your specification, but like there will be high efficiency chill water pumps will be used. Your secondary pumps, your TS pump will be working on VFDs, so you will get any additional energy saving there. When I say of the cooling towers, these cooling towers are the, like your typical normal cooling towers, but of the bigger capacity. And this will be having the CTI approved cooling towers, because the effectiveness of the cooling towers will drive your energy efficiency of chillers. Because here, when we are going for such a big capacity, every 0.1 kilowatt will make a big difference in terms of the annual saving. So for this one, like they are going for CTI approved cooling towers to get a better performance. And there will be a VFD for cooling tower fans, because like the capacity of the motor for cooling tower fans, it will be quite high here. So they will, with the help of VFD of cooling tower, they will be get the benefit of the atmospheric temperatures. And there will be online dosing, chemical dosing system will be there just to ensure a proper quality of, to maintain the water quality in terms of the bacteria, bio growth, your corrosions and descaling and other purposes. Okay, just to ensure that we will get a proper, we can maintain a good condition into your condenser itself. Now, whenever I go for any presentations of one, I always get one question. That is, when I say about cooling towers, people always ask questions when you're talking about energy efficiency and you are using cooling towers. So you're using a lot of fresh waters for cooling towers. But here we won't be using a fresh water, we will be using the recycled water from the STP. As such, we are going for a cluster development, and we are planning to have a centralized system for a full city or a cluster. We can have a like a same way for the STP also. We will collect all the sewage and treat that into STP, and we can generate a recycled water which can be used for cooling tower and irrigation purposes. So we are not using any fresh water, and we will be using the recycled water from the STP. Now the very important component, like which is normally not used into normal chilled water plants, that is your stratified thermal energy storage. So this there are like in terms of TS tanks, there will be two types of TS tank will be there. One will be the chilled water type, and second is ice based. I'm trying to take the brief for both of them. So when I go for the first one, the chilled water type, it is called stratified thermal energy storage tank. So what will happen, like whenever you are taking water into generating excess chilled water in the part load hours in the morning or in the evening, you will store that waters into this TS tank. This will be a TS tank, is a normal silo tank with the insulators, and there will be two major main component. One will be the diffusers at the bottom and one will be at the top. The bottom diffuser is for any kind of water coming in or going out of low water temperature. When I say low water temperature, or will be that 5 degree water coming generated by the chilled water or going to the building site. When I say hot water here, it will be the coming from the building, that is 14 degree water that will be stored in, will always come in or going out from the top only. Okay, now just to understand how this works. Okay, so in normal case, when you are pouring two different temperature waters, maybe let's say for our example only, a 5 degree water and 14 degree waters, when you add into that of one single tank, it will get mixed with each other's. That 5 degree water and 14 degree, if I store into equal amount, it will be mixed and it will be give, I will be get around 7 degree or 8 degree waters. Okay, but why this mixing happens? The mixing happens because of the turbulence. Okay, so to if I avoid the turbulence, I can avoid the mixing also. And to ensure that one, we are having these diffusers here, which will reduce your turbulence. So whenever like any water comes in, like for example, if you see here, the chilled water coming from the chillers comes here and go into diffuser first, and then it enters into TS tank from the diffuser at a laminar velocity. And the same way, whenever any water, a hot water, which is at 14 degree or 15 degree, which leaves the TS tank, will be from the top, and that is again from the with the help of diffuser only. So again, there will be a laminar velocity will be there. So in the tank, there won't be any kind of turbulence inside the water one. So there will be a laminar flow when the water is coming in and water going out. And with the help of laminar flow, there won't be any kind of mixing. Now, if there is no mixing, then at the time that water will get their locations, they are getting separated with the help of density of the water. So low temperature has a high density and high water temperature is a low density. So the low temperature water that is at 4 degree or 5 degree will be settled down at the bottom because we are allowing them to enter from the bottom only. And the hot water, which is 14 degree or 15 degree, which will be on the top only because we are allowing them to enter in the TS tank from the top only. So there will be like top layer will be the hotter one and cold water will be at the lower one. So they will be separated out by the their density difference, because one is really high density, second will be the low density. And they are not getting mixed because there is no turbulence. Now, when they are not mixing, okay, so there will be like, you will be able to find conduction between the two layers because they are not mixing. When they are getting the charge or they are getting discharge, when I say charge, that is adding the thermal energy. When I get a discharge, so by taking the thermal energy out from the TS tank. So while charging and discharging, whenever there will be waters, when they are contact, they will go up and down. But the cold water and hot water will be in touch with each other. They are not mixing, but there will be conduction between the two water, between 14 degree and 5 degree. And that conduction will form a small layer of a mixed temperature. And that is called as thermocline. So you will be able to see thermocline here, which is between the hot water and the cold waters. And this thermocline is happening because of the conduction between the two temperature waters. There is no mixing between the two waters. And this thermocline's thickness beside your efficiency of thermal storage. Now this particular image will give you idea how the charging discharging will happen with the help of chillers. because whenever we are having a part load conditions, we are running chillers into full load and we will charge the TS tanks. When we are having in the peak load and we are having requirement of additional cooling beyond the capacity of chillers, we are taking discharge from the TS tanks. Okay, and sometimes we will be only using TS tank also in case of emergency where we are not running a TS tank or we are having very less requirement of the cooling capacity. Similarly, one can also think of having ice-based thermal storage also. When I say ice-based thermal storage, there are more number of options are available in terms of the technologies. Almost as I come across various technologies, there are 4 to 5 technologies are there. Okay. But when I say ice-based thermal storage, their main functions or main technology is to store thermal energy by changing the phase. So they will be storing the energy into the latent heat of the freezing they are storing there. So in case of the chill water, we are storing the sensible energy. And here we are storing in terms of the latent heat of freezing. So when we use this ice base, we can store more amount of heat in a smaller areas. We are able to store more amount of heat into a smaller volume. So in case of ice base storage, that is a benefit. Because in the same volume where we are having a maybe if I say 10,000 ton capacity for a chill water tank, we can have a 40,000 ton capacity by ice based thermal storage. But the another difference is that is a plus point. And another negative side is we need to have a chiller which is not your normal chillers. You need to use a brine chiller there because you would like to freeze the water. So you need to use a chiller which give you temperature below -2 degree. So in case of stratified chill water tank, we are using the same chillers. And if you are going for ice-based storage, you will be using a separate brine chiller for charging and discharging. Now that in the starting of the, when you are conceptualizing your DCS plan, you can do your thorough study in terms of which will be more beneficial. Because there are district cooling plant where are having a stratified storage also. And there are ice-based thermal storage also, because they need to consider like what are the off-peak hours they are getting and what are the charges for off-peak hours, the electrical charges benefit they are getting. So based on that one, they select which to go for stratified or ice-based thermal storage. Now, this all component was with reference to chilled water plants. Now, very important component for us in a district cooling plant is your chill water piping, because chill water pipings are the lifeline for the district cooling system, because they are carrying chill water from the plant up to the buildings. So these pipes will be in the range of 600 dia to 2000 mm dia, 600 to 2 meter dia. And the length of the piping will vary between the buildings from few meters to few kilometers also. Okay, so like the project I had worked in the GIFT City, like initial phase, we had installed 5 kilometer pipings, and it's as an overall one, we had planned that is for 16 kilometer piping there. And very important component in this one is your one is the installations, whether is a there can be a buried installations, the way we can see the top pictures, okay, where we will be the pipe buried inside the underground in the soil. And there can be like above ground insulation also. So, and very important component here is the insulation of the chill water pipe, because that space is very important, because these pipes are bigger in size and in a longer run also. So they are, if you are not having proper insulation there, you'll lose a lot of thermal energy from because of the improper insulations. So in case of district cooling plant, this piping, they are going for pre-insulated pipings. So because, why pre-insulated piping? Because when we are doing a manual wrapping of the insulations, we are applying some solutions and then try to put our insulation over the pipe. It is a manual process. And there are always chances are that there will be an air gap between the pipe and the insulation materials. So when we are going for pre-insulated pipings, there won't be any kind of air gap between the pipe and the insulation material. So we are getting a good quality there. So most district cooling plants, they are going for pre-insulated piping. And again, there will be like the pre-insulated pipings against itself is a big subject, because there are various technologies available for pre-insulations also. There are spray type pre-insulations are there. There are fill type pre-insulation technologies are there. So each of them has their own pros and cons. So while selecting your insulation, you need to go in a much detailed study of selection of the insulations, the thickness, the K value, the mechanical strength, type of technologies, and everything. They can be installed underground also, above ground also. And like when we say above ground, there are also various options are available. The way like in a GIFT City, the project which is very close to Ahmedabad, they had installed chill water pipe into above ground, but that will be again into a utility tunnel, which is buried tunnel. So you can access the pipe and that entire area is buried in the ground. So they have a very good utility tunnel, underground utility tunnels, which carries district cooling piping and all other utility services for the entire city. A very important component here is a special support design for piping, because whenever we are doing any piping for our in a building, chill water piping for in our buildings, we never go for any kind of piping design or stress analysis. Okay. But as such, these are the very big pipes and laid within the on a longer span. We need to go for a pipe stress analysis, and based on that result, there will be a special support requirement will be there. So that is a very essential component here, which we are not doing into normal chill water plants. And second one is to ensure redundancy of pipe networks, because these pipes are a lifeline for your entire cluster development. Any kind of breakage into chill water system will stop your overall operation for the city. So you need to ensure while doing piping design to have a proper redundancy into piping also. Because in case of your any issue, you need to take a shutdown of your pipes, or then any leakage into pipe, or any breakdown into pipe, the operation of the city should not stop. So whenever you are doing a master planning for your city, you need to ensure that you'll always have a redundancy for piping network also. The way we are having a redundancy in case of our chiller selection, 2 working, 1 standby, 3 working, 1 standby, or your pumps, everywhere we are always having a redundancy. Similarly, you need to plan for your piping also, because here that becomes very critical component. Now, another important, like we started with plant equipment. We taken the chill water piping network. Now we are coming up to buildings. So when we come to buildings, we have a battery limit, that is your PHE. Okay. I'm not taking right now into how the system will be there inside the building, because it will be only a low side work will be there. Okay. So when we say this one, control and metering, that is when we I enter into any consumer system, there will be metering will be there for whatever the energy they consume. And based on that one, they will be billed for that usage. So being a, if I am a consumer, I will be getting a chill water from the chill water plants. I need not to invest any kind of any equipment there, but I will be getting a chill water at my doorstep, at my PHE. And whatever thermal energy I use, I need to pay for that one. So like in terms of like, there will be like, if you see here, this will be a DCS side and this will be a building side. So the way I had taken the example of 514, so there will be a DCS metering will be here. There will be a flow meters. There will be a RTDs will be there. And that RTD and flow meter combining will give you thermal energy, what is used by the users. Okay. And both the parties, the DCS operators and the users, both are having an agreement in terms of what the supply temperature will be there and what will be the return temperature will be there. Okay. Because that is a very essential for both the parties, the supply temperature as well as the return temperature. So, and in terms of the energy rates, when we say what should be the charges, how the charges will be played, like the way it will be similar to your energy bills or electricity bills. The way if you say any commercial bill of electricity, there will be connection charges will be there, because whenever you apply for the connections, you pay connection charges based on whatever demand you ask for. There will be a variable cost, or you can say consumption charges, whatever the kilo units you consume, you pay per unit charges there. And there will be a demand cost. So whatever demand you ask, whether you are asking for 500 ton you are asking about 1,000 ton. Based on that cost, you are paying a demand cost. And that this cost will vary based on the how the financial modeling of overall DCS plant is taken, has taken care. And monthly bill generation and bill collections are important part of DCS operations. So apart from technical side, there is another commercial side will be there of the DCS zone, because DCS plant is like your electrical GV or your torrent power company. Okay, they are generating energy, they are distributing energy, and they are collecting the charges for the your energy uses. So they will be generating the monthly bills, they will be connecting the collection, they are having the bill collections, and all commercial activity will be there. Because along with technical side, there will be a commercial parties associated here. And in this all this case, the BMS plays very important role here, because it will be like a central controller from one place. You can able to control everything. It is not the case like you go like the way it be, you are not going for each reading for each BTU meters and collecting the bills. It will be an automated system with the help of the BMS. These are the summary of benefits from DCS one. So if you see here, like we had this, like we can, like we are going for high COP chillers. We are going for high delta T temperature difference or high delta T. So with the we are saving the power and we are saving the material for the chilled water piping. VFD on chilled water pumps, VFD for cooling towers, pre-insulations, we are saving the thermal loss there. We are using the eco-friendly refrigerants, okay, R134, or in a, some of the European countries, they are going for now more on the natural refrigerants. They are using ammonia also. Like if I, you can go on the website, you can search for Heathrow Airport. They are using ammonia as a refrigerants. So now another culture is getting developed to use a natural refrigerants for this kind of the projects, which are more towards the energy environment friendly. And use of STP recycled water for cooling towers. Combine it together, there will be low energy consumptions, low water consumptions, use of recycled waters, and minimum impact of refrigerant on the environments. So ultimately, if you combine all these things, this will be sustainable development, where you are reducing the CO2 emissions, you are using, you are saving the fresh water usage, you are reducing the natural resources, because you reduce your power demand itself. So from that particular point of view, you are reducing your natural resources, reduce environmental damage, reduce environmental damage, because you are generating less amount of CO2, you are not using fresh waters, you are using, you try to use recycled waters, so you are reducing the environmental damage here. Now, these are the various benefit of the DCS system. So low initial cost for the building owners. As such, building owners need not to invest any kind of in the plants. They are not investing into chillers. They are not investing into entire plants. That will be done by the DCS operators. So as a building owners, my initial cost will come down. Lower electrical demand for the individual building. So if you take any typical building, there will be around 60 to 65% load will be from that of the air conditioning load. But here, that all major component of air conditioning, one like chillers, pumps, has been taken care into by the, are not in the part of building. They are part of the DCS plant. So in the electrical demand for building will come down. So associated will be there, the benefit will be what? When I reduce my electrical demand one, I'm reducing my monthly cost for the electrical bill, because in case of electrical bills, monthly electrical bill, there are two components. One is the demand cost and one is the consumption cost. Demand cost is based on whatever you are demanding from the electricity company. And in case of DCS, the billing users, is they are reducing their electrical demand. So their monthly demand cost, what they are paying to electricity company, is reducing here. That is what I'm trying to say, lower operating cost for system owners. Lower space requirement for cooling system at building, because like they are not having any chillers, pumps, cooling towers, that they only need to install the PHE, the circulation pumps, and AHU. So that will be like very small space required into for PHE and pumps compared to anti-chill water plants. Improve supply reliability, because as such, this will be taken care by a professional company to provide a chill water to at your doorsteps. So the supply reliability has improved now. Because how that will be improved by, in case of like I'm running for a 500 ton plant, I will not be employ a good technical persons to handle the plant. Okay. Whereas like I for a 10,000 plant or a 30,000 plant or a 75,000 ton plant, they can employ a complete team of highly qualified peoples. Eliminate the need for the building owners to buy, service and maintain cooling equipments. Environment friendly refrigerants are kept contained at one central location only. So that is a very important, because if you see in the current conditions, like if I take example of Ahmedabad, okay, we are having a split ACs, one at least for each flat, and every outdoor unit has a your refrigerant system there. Whereas when we have a district cooling system, we having all this refrigerant located at one place only. So that is always helps in terms of the environment, the hazard coming out from the refrigerants. Optimum number of standby equipment. So if I take that for our what example we had taken, that 40 million square feet area, if I say there are like say 40 buildings are there, and if I am going for a central system for each building, so there will be two working, one standby I considered, and there will be one standby chillers, one standby pumps, one standby cooling towers for all this that 40 buildings. So there will be 40 standby units will be there in that clusters. But if I go for district cooling system, I can go for with the one or two standby systems for that entire clusters. So that reduce the your that can saves your natural resources also. Lower operating manpower for centralized maintenance facilities, because the owners are not is not requiring to have a skilled staff with them. That will be taken care by the centralized plant. Now, one of the very important component, because we had discussed about the technical part, what is the system, how it works, what are the components, what are the benefits. Okay. Now, apart from that one is very important component for DCS is economics of DCS. Because when I plan for any DCS for any cluster one, I need to think of like I need to think like a utility company, because what will be my overall investment? How I will be able to recover my capex recovery? How I will be recover my opex recovery? And the cost compatibility with the convection system, because people's like try to use for the convection system, maybe a split AC or VRF or maybe chill water system, and everyone will try to compare the whatever the rate. A DCS company is charging with that particular rate only. So that we need to plan in a proper way. Then another one is like monthly metering and billing system, battery limit with the consumers. And the fifth one, battery limit with the consumers, is also like we need to take care in terms of legal aspect also, because this would be like when I'm giving service to another one, so that particular becomes your legal contract there, and we need to see in terms of the legality of all aspect when we are connecting, we are having the contract for this one. So this is only summary for the challenges when we plan for any DCS. I just taken the example for example, when I start for anyone, there will be demand assessment will be there. Because for any cluster, what will be the demand based on the number of buildings, amount of built-up areas. And normally when I go for DCS, we need to work along with the urban authority itself, because that will be our main source for input when we start thinking of DCS. So planning in line with the city development, there is urban authority is very essential component there. Flexibility in the plant design. So for example, if I said like what the example we had taken, 40 million square feet, we are having 75,000 plant will be there, and 35,000 TS tank will be there. So it is not going to come in a one day. I need to plan along with the city development. I can't put entire 110,000 plant in a first go. I will divide that into various stages, part one, part two, part three, and that will be in the along the how the development of the city is going on. then optimization of the piping networks, physical infrastructure for current and future scenario, as I said, like how the city will be growing, optimization of plant energy consumptions. So I need to work out on the consumptions of each component, user satisfactions, which is very important because they should be getting proper cooling one, and compatibility of the low side infrastructures. This is very important because, as I said in our example, that like most of the district cooling operators use 9 degree, 10 degree or 11 degree delta T. So when they are going for such a high delta T, on the building side also, they need to have a system that is compatible with this 9 degree or 10 degree delta T. So all the component inside the building, your PHE, your chill water pumps, your AHU coil selections, should be as per the 9 degree or 10 degree based on the whatever the DCS operator has given your specifications. So that is a very essential component there. So these are the all challenges associated with district cooling system. So if I take any one of them, we can discuss maybe more than 2 hours on each of the topics, because they itself is a challenge. Like, we need to work very thoroughly when we plan for district cooling system. These are the some of the energy optimization methods are there. So absorption chillers you can use instead of, like we had while my presentation I had given all about electrical chillers, but you can also have a energy optimizations by use of waste heat with the help of absorption chillers. You can also have a combined heat and power plants. We have a that kind of model has been implemented in Gurgaon, DLF Cyber City, waste incinerations, where we can connect the waste heat and you can use for the absorption chillers. Renewable electrical energy source can be used. Use of solar heats, and there are also options are there in the western part. A lot of players are exploring various options for using the abnormal source of renewable source of the or waste heat source for the running the this district cooling plant. This is a comparison between normal your split centralized plant system and district cooling system. So I will be going very briefly for this all points because already I had taken almost 1 hour 15 minutes. So I take the first point, it is a very important the efficiency. So if you are going for a split system, it will be 1.3, 1.4 kilowatt per ton. You are going for a centralized plant, which very efficiency, that will be 1 kilowatt per ton. And if you are going for a district cooling plant, it will be 0.9 kilowatt per ton. Just to ensure that one, this 1 kilowatt per ton will be your plant capacity I'm talking about. Not I'm talking about the low side capacity. Then redundancy in the system. When you are going for a split system, you do not have any redundancy. Whereas if you go for centralized and district cooling system, the reliability factors will increase. Economy of the scales. So that is, economy of scale is more connected with diversity. So when you are going for diversity, you are not having any diversity with split AC. You will get diversity of building use for a centralized plant. But when I go for a district cooling system, you will get a diversity of entire clusters. Improved electrical demand curves. So because when you are going for split AC, you need to have a demand for each area without any diversity. And so that will be in the range of 1.4 kilowatt per ton. When you are going for centralized plant, you are getting 1 kilowatt per ton with the building diversity. But when we are going for a district cooling plant, you are getting a bigger diversity, and you can also employ thermal storage there, because in a normal 500 ton or 800 ton or 1000 ton, it is difficult to have a thermal storage there. Sorry, I had seen a lot of projects where people are employing thermal storage, and it is a very good one because that provides reduce your electrical demand curves. But that is always possible with the district cooling system. In terms of the noise, when I talk about split, it is because the units compressors are very close to you. It is very loud. When I go for centralized system, the building will be having all vibration and noise within the building. But when I go for district cooling system, all these noisy equipments had been placed into one central locations. So in the building, it is very, there is no vibration from these equipments or no noise from these equipments. Then life cycle cost, there's a increase of state is highest, better and base. Aesthetically, like we had started with the pictures, which was like with the split ACs and VRFs, and split ACs. And then when I go for centralized system, we need to either place all our equipment on the roof or in the basements. So that will be like, again, taking your space. But when we go for the district cooling system, they won't be having much equipments in case of your buildings. They all will be shifted into your plant level. So like if I say cooling towers, there won't be any cooling tower space required into your buildings. There is no chiller space required into your building levels. And maintenance hazards for the users, the end users. So when I have a split, there is a full part and none. Okay, this is like a comparison, like you, most of us are from the air conditioning field, so it is very easy to judge. Now, just to give you some examples, like it is like a challenging system, and this challenge already India has accepted, and we has implemented a first district cooling plant into our GIFT city, because it is like our Gujarat projects and near to Ahmedabad only. And we had implemented 10,000 ton first phase installation there, and it is operational from last five years. As I said, like in case of DCS, you need to go for stage by stage installation of the system. So their overall estimation of the GIFT city is 180,000 ton, and they had planned to go by phases of 10,000 ton or 15,000 ton. And these are some of the example. It is very few example I had tried to take, and not all the example. These are the few small example just to give you idea about what the amount of turns capacity are there in district cooling system. So like if you say like city of Arabia is 120,000 turns. Okay. So these are the some of the examples. In India also, we are having a few district cooling plant, not actually district cooling plant, because when I say district cooling plants, it will be like commercially operated. So even if you're not operating commercially, some of the IT companies I had observed, like they are having a centralized plant for their 4 to 5 buildings into same campus. So there is also a mini district cooling system, but they need not to have all that financial modeling, what we have, monthly billing and other things, the battery limits, that will not be there. But the technology, you can say the benefits, what centralized plant for multiple buildings. So that kind of things are also present in India. Like Infosys is there, one campus of Reliance is there, where they are having a central plant for their multiple buildings into their own campus. So this was a little brief on district cooling system. Thank you everyone. And I'm just like, again, like to sorry everyone, because there was a small technical glitch from my end. Because of, I was not able to connect properly on my regular laptop because of the IT policy not to install Zoom into in my regular laptop. So that was like little difficulties was there. So thank you everyone for listening me quietly. So if any questions will be there, I will be happy to take them.
Thank you, sir. Vijay sir is there. He will take question and answer, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Gaurang bhai, there is a question and appreciation also from many participants. One question is there from Mr. Mohit Goel, that why is typical temperature approach considered for Indian conditions in PHEs for DCS?
Approach will be in the range of 0.8 to 1 degree or maximum 1.2 degree. Because we are not able to take much higher approach there. And hence, we are going for PHE there. I think I had answered the right what he's trying to question. When they say approach, it will be approach across the PHE.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And another question from the same participant is there. Is TS better or VFD chiller is better?
Okay. There are always these questions comes to me. This is very frequent questions. But see, when I go for VFD, always like there will be a straightforward 3 to 4% loss will be there in VFD, the first thing. Second one, when I go for thermal energy storage, I always get benefit in terms of the using into off-peak hours, because most electrical company, when you are having such a big demand, they give you relaxations when you run your power into off-peak hours. So when I run my chillers into night hours and store into TS tanks, I get some rebate from them also. So that helps me in terms of the financial modeling or reducing the, my charges to the, my users, which is not possible with the help of VFD chillers. So in that terms, my always preference will be the TS tanks.
Thank you. Another question is there from Mr. Jitendra Rai. He's asking that can we use brine, that is MEG, to get lower temperature?
I think so, he answered the question.
So that is in terms of the circulating to entire city?
Yeah.
So in terms that will be like that is I think not possible, because you will not be able to take the brine to entire city, because at one phase of time like there will be water will be there and there will be ice formation will be there. So like we can't use brine for my entire network, because like I can't circulate water of less than 4 degrees up to the my building users, because when I take a lower temperature than 4.5 degree in the building level, there will be a freezing in the PHE, because in the building I can't run brine again. Because when I use brine, I need to take care a lot of precaution in terms of corrosion also.
Okay.
Yeah, another question is there. I think it is definitely covered into your this presentation, but again, I am just asking you, what is the average IKW per TR for chiller alone and IKW per TR along with pumps, AHU and CT?
IKW of chiller alone will be in the range of 0.6 kilowatt per ton. And when I compare as entire system, there will be in the range of 1 kilowatt per ton, including if I include even like my low side also.
Yeah, and another question, I think this question is regularly people are asking in your this lecture, that is, what is the typical size of or tonnage capacity requirement where the solution is commercially viable?
See, commercially viable, when I say like that can be like as small as 5,000 ton also. Okay. Definitely like I can't have like district cooling plant for 500 ton. So we can say start thinking from the 5,000 ton where you have a multiple buildings and you can have a centralized plant there. So obviously like for 500 ton plant, you can't have a DCS, but whenever I say DCS, it will be always a cluster development. Maybe it can be a 3 building also, a bigger tonnage, or it can be a 40 buildings also. Okay. So that will be, we can say, viable figures can be start from 5,000 tons onwards as a just a preliminary figures.
Right. I think this is the last question as we have a limitation of time as well. So the question is, major AC load in daytime and tariff should have some TOD charges, and in this is done at building design itself. There will be reduction in overall cost of installation of AC plus electrical. I think this is not a clear question. Are you getting it or should I repeat?
No, I didn't get the question.
So question is that major AC load in daytime and tariff should have some TOD charges. And in this is if this is done at building design itself, there will be reduction in overall cost of installation of AC or electrical.
In terms of like, I think he is trying to cover like peak demand charges, which is there into like in the morning 6 to 10 and in the evening from 6 to 10. In the most of the electrical company, they are having a peak demand charges between this particular driving time. And with the help of PL, and they are giving some rebate into a night operations against the peak hour charges. Okay, so with the help of DCS, we are able to take care of this particular case, because what we are trying to do is we are trying to store the energy in the off-peak hours and try to run into the peak hour charges or peak load time. So that always help us in terms of the averaging out the cost towards the generation of the cooling capacity. So that peak hour charges, what normally are always there into normal system, can be reduced here with the help of DCS. I think this is what he is trying to ask.
Yeah, I think that was only the question. I also understood the same from the question. I think now this is the, as it was the last question, but this question is very simple. I think it is also covered into the presentation, but again, we are asking. So question is that, what could be the better option between thermal tank and ice storage? And what could be the technical advantage on the same? How to convince someone on the capex cost who might be an investor or an end user?
See, always in terms of convincing someone is always you need to work out the your figures. Okay, so you need to work out your capex, you need to work out your opex, and what will be your benefit in terms of the capex versus opex. So, and that is also the base for the selection of ice base and selection of the chilled water storage tank. So if I give you a rough idea, because when I go for ice-based storage tank, I will be able to store more thermal energy into the same volume. In the, like if I say 100 cubic meter area is there, I will be able to store almost 3 to 4 times energy than chilled water thermal storage. Okay. But against that one, I need to have a separate chillers for generating the ice, because I need to install, have a brine circuit there. Whereas when I go for a chilled water storage tank, I will be using the same chiller which are there into my circuit to store the energy into thermal chilled water thermal storage. I didn't require any separate chillers. So I am having a less capex there compared to ice-based thermal storage. So here, like, you need to consider your costing per square feet, because I had seen or had studied this one, like almost like 90% people are going for chilled water storage only, because they need not to have a separate chillers and separate operations for the different chillers. But those district cooling plant where they are having an ice-based thermal storage, they are going because they are having a cost per square feet or the land cost very high. So there they are going for ice-based storage. So that kind of factors you need to consider. Secondly, very important factors which helps in favoring the ice-based storage is what are the night rebate they are getting. If they are getting a very good night rebate, maybe like in some most of the cases they are getting 50 paisa night rebate. But if they are getting more rebate on one, I'm just giving figure in terms of the our Gujarat conditions. But if they are getting more rebate on night operations, they should go for ice-based storage tank. There are some of the very good examples in where they had, you can go various case studies of ice-based thermal storage, where they had used very nicely to come up against the cost of the land, cost of the operations by adding more capex. So always this will be a puzzle between the capex and opex cost, and ultimately the what will be the payback periods, because there won't be any straightforward answer for this one.
True. It depends upon the system and everything.
Yes.
So now I think all questions have been already answered, and if you have many more questions, you can definitely write to an email to Isre Ahmedabad chapter. One more thing I would like to just tell you that in chat box, Hardik Bhai has put a link to become a member. Who are not a member of ISRE, please come forward and become a member. You are going to get more technical knowledge and technical sessions in ISRE. So please be forward. Now I think I'm handing over this to Venkatesh for further vote of thanks and everything.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Vijay bhai, for the handling the question and answer session. Hello?
Yeah, sir, we are able to hear you.
Thank you, Vijay bhai, for the handling the question and answer session. And as Vijay bhai has told you, please be a part of the Ishray family to get a regular update of this type of session. And you will also have, get that technical magazine bi-monthly, which will help to increase your technical knowledge. And thank you, Gaurang bhai, for this wonderful session. It was really very good session. And thank you all the participants for attending this session. I think, and seeing the question and answer, we come to know that this is a very good topic. And you and Gaurang bhai has handled it very nicely. And
thank you.
We may require to conduct this type of again for that detail with more detail. I think so.
Yeah, yes. I agree on that part.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, Gaurang Sahib. Thank you very much. And thanks to all the participants for sparing a valued time, because I was knowing that the session was going to be very interesting. And Gaurang bhai has given a true justice to the subject, because as I said in my early speech, that he is synonymous to the district cooling system.
Thank you, because like, thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much. Okay. Rajendra bhai, can we end the meeting, please?
Just a moment, sir. Prashant,
1 minute.
I would just like to add what we have given to our chapter CWC yesterday. Gaurang bhai is appointed as a technical group chair for district cooling system at Ishray HQ. So that's a real pride moment for us. And Gaurang, keep it up.
Thank you, everyone. And like it is possible only because of the like support of I always like say the support from Ishray Ahmedabad chapter, because it's like my home ground.
Okay, then let's move forward.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay.
And
Kandoju.
And Kandoju.